those that accept the glorious deliverance of Christ from the curse of the law have in the Holy Spirit a taste of the power to live our lives on this earth and the blessing of living our lives for eternity in heaven. Today we will study verses 15 to 29 of Galatians 3. I invite you to turn there. And I would like for someone to volunteer and share with us what subheading you have between verses 14 and 15 of Galatians chapter 3.
It's a changeless promise.
The tenor of the law.
The changeless what?
Promise.
Very good.
Intent of the law.
The intent of the law. Anyone else?
Abraham's covenant is not void.
Wow. That's right on. Who would like to volunteer to read verse 15 of Galatians 3 to begin our study? Galatians chapter 3, verse 15. Over here.
Brethren, I speak in a manner of men, though it is only a man's covenant. Yet, if it is confirmed, no one annuls or adds to it.
Thank you. Some translations use the word will instead of covenant. Some translations use the word ratify. What was the covenant that God made to Abraham?
He would multiply his seed.
All would be blessed
through him.
Yes. We're going to get to those. But the covenant that God made to Abraham, we read last week. Recorded in Genesis 12, verse 2 and 3. He would give him the whole earth made new. After having done what for the human race? Made us free from the what? From the curse, which he had previously ratified. So, who is the guarantor? Who is the surety of the new covenant? The everlasting covenant. Who is that?
Jesus.
Yes, Christ. In fact, in whom are all promises of the Bible fulfilled?
Jesus Christ.
Why do we utter the word amen? Through Christ. Why do we do that?
We agree.
We agree.
We agree.
So that whatever we do or say will be to the glory of whom?
God.
That's very specific. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. What else was ratified through by God through Abraham? Let's take a look at a book that we studied last quarter. 1 Peter. I need a volunteer to read 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3, 4, and 5. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3, 4, and 5. Who would like to read this for Tom? 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3, 4, and 5.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time.
Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. So what are the first fruits of the inheritance? The possession of what? The Holy Spirit. In Christ. Dwelling where? In our hearts. How? Through faith. Do you remember John 14, 15? Everyone knows John 14, 15. This is Jesus speaking. He says, if you love me, you will do something very interesting. Which is what? And what does the word keep mean?
Cherish.
Yeah, guard. Cherish, protect something very, very special. Very, very special that I have given to you. And now, everybody knows John 14, 15. Do you know verse 16? And this says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another helper. And the word helper is, in Greek, is parakletos. Very important. First four words are very important. Para means what? Well, we get the word parallel. I will give you a helper parallel to you. Why is it parallel to us? Weren't we created in God's image and likeness? Wasn't that part of our standard equipment? So why does Jesus say parallel to you? Because we kicked him out in the Garden of Eden when we decided to become what?
Self-dependent
instead of God-dependent. But does Jesus abandon us? No. He said, he even gives us the name, Parakletos. Helper, right next to you. But in order for it to come into me and I can realize it, I have to do what?
Invite
him. That's, of course, our choice. So that is the first blessing, the Holy Spirit indwelling us. If the Holy Spirit is not indwelling us, we're helpless. Didn't Jesus say when he was on this earth, I myself can do nothing? Why? Because in order to ethically and legally save us, he had to take on my nature at the incarnation. That's why Paul writes in Romans 8:3 that Jesus condemned what? Sin in whose flesh?
His
flesh. How can he condemn something that he did not have it himself to condemn? I mean, you know, this is third grade logic here. So that's the significance of the Holy Spirit being the first blessing. And when Jesus was here, how did he choose to live his life? He always let the Holy Spirit be high. He never took the initiative to do anything or even say anything. Folks, that is an incredible object lesson for us. Okay, so last week we read the seven promises of God recorded in Genesis 12, 2 and 3. What else did these promises include? Volunteer to read Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3, verses 25 and 26. So we read seven blessings recorded in Genesis 12, 2 and 3. There's something else there. Acts chapter 3, verses 25 and 26. Who would like to read that for us? Linda, thank you.
You are sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying to Abraham, and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. To you first, God having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away from every one of you.
Thank you.
Iniquities.
Thank you. The word turning there is a very, very important word. It means a 180 degree turn in your lifestyle. How does that happen? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. Right. A complete 180 degree turn. What does that mean? Yeah.
Rebirth.
Right. What else does it mean? It means that God's version of the gospel, of Christian living, can what? Become a reality in our lives. There are a lot of versions of Christian living out there. Lots. So what ratified the covenant made to Abraham?
Christ's blood.
The oath of God. The oath of God. So, when God decided to prove that his promise, his oath, was sure and unchangeable, what did he do? Again, let's go to Scripture. Hebrews 6, Hebrews chapter 6, verses 17, 18, and 19. Hebrews 6, 17, 18, and 19. Who would like to volunteer to read Hebrews 6? Not a lot. Of Hebrews 6.
Thus God, determining to show more abundantly to the heirs of the promise in the ability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we might have strong consolation, who have fled for refuge to lay hold of this hope, of the hope set before us.
Thank you. So what did God pledge? His own existence. Is that good enough for us? Okay, let's take a look at verse 16 of Galatians 3. Galatians 3, verse 16. Who would like to volunteer to read that for us? Lois?
Verse 16 of Galatians 3. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds, as of many, but as of one. And to your seed, who is Christ.
Very important that we understand, because this is the reason why Paul is writing the letter to the Galatians that were brought into the church by Paul preaching the gospel to them, but now they're being diverted. The gospel is being perverted, as we have said it previously. So it's to his offspring, singular. Is this a play on semantics, or is this a vital point here? Yeah. It has to do with one issue. How we are saved. Is it Christ alone? Or is it Christ and something else or someone else?
No, Christ alone.
Yeah. Many believe that they must make themselves acceptable to God before they can come to God, especially after we have made a terrible mistake. Is that scripture? It's satanic. Others are willing to include Christ in their lives, but not to give him the only place. They want to help God, and they're sincere. In other words, they want to do this with God. Our text, though, eliminates the assumption and the self-assertion. Our text reads, offspring, not many, but one. And to your offspring, it is Christ. It may be appropriate, because this has been distorted, it was distorted to the Galatian converts, to use a biblical contrast here. Last week, we looked at Genesis 15:6. In Genesis 15:6, God gives Abram a vision. Abram is speaking. And so God appears to him in a vision, and he says to him, Abram, I want for you to go outside of your tent. It's nighttime. And I want for you to count the stars that you're able to. And God said to Abram, the reason that I want for you to count the stars is because I want to show you how large a family I am going to bless you. At that point in time, he was 83 years old. And his 73-year-old wife, Sarai, who was childless at that point in time. So, in Genesis, and what does Abram say? I believe you. And what did God say to Abram?
I
declare you righteous. That was it. Now, fast forward to Genesis 17. Abram is now 99 years old. And God instructs him to be circumcised because God is ready now to enter into a covenant with Abram. Why did God ask Abram to be circumcised? Because in chapter 16, Abram decides to follow his wife Sarai's idea and produce a baby through Sarai's Egyptian maid. To fulfill God's promises to any member of the human race, including Abram at that point in time.
Amen.
So he tells Abram, you're going to become a father. When you're 99 years old, he's telling you, you're going to become a father. And your 89-year-old wife is going to bear a child to you. What was God's purpose? In introducing circumcision at that point in time.
He was that it was not humanly possible.
Even in those days, folks, it was impossible for a woman 89 years old to bear a child. Do we get it? I know we know the story, but do we get the biblical implication here? But that's the point. He's asking Abram to circumcise himself. What's the point here?
It was an outward sign that they were set apart and different.
This was God's way of proving that visual circumcision, or cutting off forever the idea that man can contribute anything towards his salvation. God only makes unilateral covenants or agreements with members of the human race. What's a bilateral agreement? Tom has a car he wants to sell. I agree to buy it. We agree on the price. Tom contributes what to this bilateral agreement? The car and the pink slip. Keys to the car. What do I contribute? The agreed upon what? Money. That's a bilateral agreement. But when God makes an agreement, it's a unilateral agreement. Where who does the doing?
God.
Who does the receiving?
We.
You're a wonderful class. I hope you understand what we're talking about. After the flood, God made a covenant with the beasts of the ground and the fowl of the air. What did the beasts of the ground and the fowl of the air do?
Nothing.
Did they promise God anything? I'm being a little sarcastic. Now, you can read it for yourself. Genesis 9, 9 through 16. They simply received the promise. Folks, that's all we can do. That's all God has ever asked a human being to do. Would you please accept my promises to you? I'm going to say something, and every time I say it, I get attacked. It's not original with me. I heard this thought sometime between 1971 and 1972 regarding this topic. And the statement is, salvation is not a partnership.
It's a gift.
Salvation is not a partnership.
It's a gift. There's a partnership of gifts.
And where do we learn that it's a gift? Romans 5, 15 through 17.
Free.
Where we see the word free in three verses used, how much is that? And the word gift used how many times? So in three verses, Paul is inspired to say the same thing seven times. That's why I keep asking, do we understand this? Do we understand what this means? Linda, you had your hand up.
When we speak about his promises, and we say his promises are conditional, they're conditional on our receiving them, not conditional or our being meritorious to have them. Am I correct?
Well, let's find out. Do you like parables? Jesus loved parables.
Yeah, I like
them. Why did Jesus use parables? Because they are what? Word pictures. Okay? This is a parable. Okay? This is what?
Parable.
I'm Jesus. This is salvation. And she's the human race.
Thank you.
Is that an offer?
No.
Or is that a gift?
Yeah.
Another parable. I'm Jesus. This is salvation. And she's the human race. You want to be saved? Yes or no?
Yes.
What are you going to do about it?
Works.
It's not about
a choice.
I'm trying to answer your question regarding condition. Now, so the first one is a gift, and the second one is what?
I have to get something.
It's an offer. Right. You need to take the initiative to do something. Are you with me so far? And follow this very carefully, okay? So, if the first one is a gift that Jesus gives to the human race, how can she lose that? She has to take the initiative to what? No, thank you. She has to do what? Take the initiative. So, what is the condition?
Accept.
What is the condition of salvation?
Yes.
Yes.
Not to take the initiative to give it away. Do we understand that? Because it's twisted in the Protestant world. That you and I need to take the initiative, or that you and I need to accept. And the way that they use accept is tricky. That's why I don't use it. There's nothing wrong with you using the word accept. But I know what they're coming from. So the word accept means that you're taking the initiative to accept. Are you with me?
Yes.
It is crucial that we understand what the scripture is saying. Paul.
Yes, because I said accept because it's available, salvation is available to every human, to the human race. But if they don't accept, they will not be saved. So even though salvation is available to everyone, it's not everyone will accept, and it's not everyone has accepted or received the gift that God has given.
100% correct. I choose to say it this way because I know how they use
you
the word accept.
You know where they're going, right?
I know how they twist the word accept. So I choose to say, in order for you, and this is biblical, just Romans 5, 15 through 17. In order to be lost, based on what she said, you and I, I'm just using myself. In order for me to be lost, I need to take the initiative to say what? No, thank you. If I don't take the initiative to say no thank you, what happens to me? I will be saved.
And we're told by Ellen White that when the wicked are
finally judged, they'll see the nature of their saying no thank you. And so there'll be a lot of Adventists in that group, unfortunately, that all agreed with everything you just said, but they said no thank you to the preparation for heaven. You see, the gift, God has given that to us. There's nothing we can change about that. He's given it to us whether we want it or not. It's still ours. But there's a preparation for heaven. And that includes the gift working in us. That's what Paul identifies the gospel in Colossians 1, verse 27. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And so it's not just a theory or a theological concept. We all go, amen. God has to do some work in here, too.
That
we need to cooperate with him.
Yes. That's another subject.
Well, we got to give it both so that we don't misunderstand.
Yeah. Right now, we're just dealing with Galatians 3:16. We're going to come to what you just brought up. It is crucial for us to understand that what we're talking about here right now is, here we go again, salvation is not a partnership. We're just talking about salvation, how, what Jesus did for the human race. The great controversy between God and Satan is how we are saved. Do we understand that? It's how we are saved. It's Christ alone. No contribution on our part. So in Galatians 3:16, we have a contrast between the what? The fleshly offspring, Ishmael, and the spiritual offspring, who?
Isaac.
The fleshly offspring have no share whatsoever in the spiritual what? Inheritance. But God, being a God of love, what did he do for Hagar and Ishmael? He blessed them. But when God said to Abram, I want for you to take your only son Isaac, your what?
Only son.
Only, biologically, was that correct? No. He already produced a baby with Hagar. But spiritually, I want for you to take your what? And sacrifice. Do we understand the difference there? We must constantly be aware of that. I believe, I'm going to get in trouble for saying this, but I can prove it to you. Not now. The book or the letter to the Galatians was written for two groups of people. The approximately six churches that Paul raised in southern, what we know today as southern Turkey, and our beloved church. It's the only two groups of people that it applies to. All the other Protestant churches are being taught that when you die, you go to heaven. And all you have to do is intellectually accept that Jesus came to this earth and you're in. That's your passport to heaven. We know that that's not biblically accurate. That leaves us. We are now teaching that we contribute to our salvation. Mm-hmm. In August of 1976, a meeting was convened in Palmdale, California, where all of the Bible scholars and administrators came together because there was an issue that the